It seems like there's a new term showing up in the data landscape roughly every week or two at this point. But some terms really stick and didn't exist a few years ago. And one of those is reverse ETL. So what is reverse ETL? Well, before diving into that, it probably makes sense to just set the stage with some basic information on data warehouses in general. Companies above a certain size, the data warehouse is basically a place that anyone around the company can go to analyze information across all parts of the business. So the idea of a data warehouse is it's a central database that you can dump all your information into from all parts of the business. You're basically, you know, taking copies of Salesforce and Facebook ads and Google Sheets and application databases and replicating them into this data warehouse so that you can analyze it and build reports off of it. And the idea of ETL is it's basically describing the process of bringing data from all these disparate data sources that I mentioned into the data warehouse. So it stands for extract, transform, and load. A more modern way to do this over the last 5-7 years has been extract, load, and transform, or ELT. But the real intent is the same. With ETL or ELT, people are referring to the process of bringing data into the data warehouse so that you can query it there. Now, the idea of reverse ETL actually changes the way that data warehouses are used altogether. So typically in an enterprise environment, the data warehouse would be used for analytics, reporting, business intelligence. It's really used for, you know, strategic insights and analytics. Now, what reverse ETL is saying is that as the importance of data is growing in organizations, data needs to be used for more than just analytics and reporting. It should be used in all the operational day-to-day processes of every part of a business. So the idea of reverse ETL is now that you've built as a company this kind of central repository of data from all parts of the business in a data warehouse, and you know, it might not be all data across all parts of the business, but probably the closest thing to it in a lot of companies. Reverse ETL is about flipping the process and taking data from the data warehouse and moving it back into these operational systems where your different business teams are doing work out of. So an example use case of this would be something simple, like if you have salespeople who are in a tool like Salesforce, prioritizing their day based on the recency of, you know, customers interacting with your online application. They wanna make sure they reach out to customers who, you know, logged into the application most recently and engage those since your product is fresh on their minds. So with reverse ETL, you can take data like last login, which is a super simple SQL query, pull a data point like that from most databases or data warehouses, and stream it directly into a tool like Salesforce so that when a salesperson who's not staring at Tableau all day, but is staring at something like Salesforce all day, is in there, they can actually see this rich customer information. Another example would be, that's probably one of the most common use cases of reverse ETL, is optimizing and personalizing your marketing initiatives. Let's say you're a company like Walmart and you want to run advertising to your customers that are really tailored to their activity on your website or, you know, their past store purchases or something that you know about. Well, those advertisements are going to be orchestrated through something like Facebook ads or Google ads. Or if it's an email campaign you're sending to customers that, you know, have already logged into your product or you know about, but you're trying to encourage them to do repeat purchases, you might be sending emails to them in something like Salesforce Marketing Cloud or Adobe or Marketo. This is just kind of an example. And to effectively use those tools, send super targeted communications to your customers, the missing link is often having the data readily available in those systems. And reverse ETL is a really effective way of solving this in modern organizations that have tons of this data in the data warehouse. With the process of reverse ETL, you're basically using that central hub that you're using to analyze your marketing campaigns and understand your customers. You're bringing that back into the operational system so that you can define, you know, triggered campaigns or custom audiences inside of them that receive different emails or orchestrate, you know, different customer journeys. So reverse ETL is really a technical concept of, you know, flipping the ETL process, and instead of bringing data from these source systems into the data warehouse, you're taking data from the data warehouse, or often not raw data, but insights. And you're bringing those insights back into the operational system so that your company can deliver much more value, business value, really, from the data investment that they're making in the warehouse. So a common question that I used to get all the time is, isn't this just ETL? And it's a good question. At a theoretical level, these folks are right. ETL and reverse ETL are, you know, moving data from one place to another. With reverse ETL, it kind of changes the paradigm and changes the way that businesses think about the warehouse as a whole, imagine writing to a system like Braze, which is a marketing system. And I'm not trying to point fingers here, I'm just using an example that's top of mind. One of the challenges with getting data into a system like Braze is that every time a column is sent to them, not a row, but a column is sent to Braze, so a trait about a user, like their lifetime value, or did they check out their card, or do they belong in audience 1, 2, or 3? Every time that kind of column is sent to Braze as an API call to do things like update a user, they actually count that towards your rate limiting system of Braze. And that's just due to how Braze organizes their infrastructure internally, I'm presuming. Obviously, it's a closed source system. We can't know the internals, but we just have to think about stuff like that when we're writing to these third-party systems that are managed by some other engineering team at some SaaS company or ad network or whatever it is. Obviously, there's a lot of nuances around that. Like, what do you do if a value is going to null? And how do you handle zero values? And, you know, all sorts of different nuances that really depend on system to system. And you have to do that for every single destination that you sync to, and as those destinations evolve. Whereas with something like ETL, you're writing to a consistent system that was built to ingest large amounts of data, like a data warehouse. And you really own the structure of it, right? You can dump data into Snowflake in any structure, and then with Snowflake, you have the power, or any data warehouse for that matter, you have the power to transform and analyze and munch and crunch the data any way you want. Whereas with, you know, reverse ETL, you need to be super careful about how you're putting data into the system, not just per system, but per use case and per customer. A lot of people ask me, how does reverse ETL work? We understand some of the challenges of it. We understand why it's different than ETL, but like, how does reverse ETL actually work at a technical level? The general high level process is that you're connecting to a source, which is going to be a data warehouse, having a SQL query or some sort of data model that you're accessing from the source on a regular schedule. So this can be a SQL query very often. It could be a table, it could be a view, it could be anything that you're able to pull from data warehouse system in the end of the day. Then you need to know how to translate that data into effectively API calls for a destination system. So how do I translate this data into the format that would be receivable by different destination systems, whether it's Salesforce or Braze or Facebook, and they each have their own kind of nuances, desired state, which may also depend on your use case. And lastly, you need a scalable platform to execute the API calls against these systems and get the data into there. Now that's the high level process. That being said, to actually have a, you know, robust reverse ETL pipeline that's, you know, powering marketing or some operational activity, production activity for your business, a lot more goes into it. As an example, first and most obvious thing is that these data pipelines need to be able to handle a lot of scale, and with the kind of need for speed as well as efficiency from a cost perspective, you need to make sure you're only operating on the data that is relevant. So a lot of times I see people write reverse ETL pipelines internally. They kind of write a quick Python script that runs a SQL query every night, loops through all the rows, makes API calls in something like Facebook. The first issue I see people run into there is that you can't be sending all your data to something like Facebook every hour or every day. It's just not feasible from a scale perspective. So one of the things that reverse ETL platforms often build is the system of diffing that can actually sit on top of the data warehouse, generate temporary tables, and, you know, understand what data changed between the last time we ran this reverse ETL model or query on the data warehouse. So now that you understand what reverse ETL is, and likely you've, you know, thought of some use cases across the business, if there's not a business team banging on your door asking about this, the question is, how are you going to solve it?